Hello, everyone, and welcome to this program presented by the Rajah Shriners in Reading. We have a very interesting and a very worthwhile and diverse program planned for this evening, and we hope that you will take a little bit away from this program, a little bit more knowledge about who the Shriners are and some things that we do. We have a program broken into two halves this evening. We're going to be looking, first of all, at the Philadelphia Shriners Hospital for Children, and the second half, we'll be looking at some of the events that have taken place in 2015, looking ahead to 2016, and some things that will be happening next year with some of the officers, and also a very special 25th annual Afternoon of Music presented by the Rajah Chanters. I'm Greg Lewis, a past potentate and director of public relations for Rajah Shrine in Reading. And with me on the first half of the program is a past potentate of Rajah and also chairman emeritus of the Philadelphia Shriners Hospital for Children and also one of the Rajah's hospital ambassadors from the Lehigh Valley area and also a driver coordinator, Noble Paul Shaw. First of all, to you, illustrious sir, Frank Caltagirone, what is the duties of those on the board of directors at the Shriners Hospital, particularly in Philadelphia?
Well, Greg, thank you very much for having me. The most important thing for the board members to do is oversee all of the other shrine centers that participate in the Philadelphia unit, which consists of 22 shrine centers. Basically, our main purpose is to raise money for Shriners Hospital.
When we look at the Shriners Hospital for Children, there's 22 hospitals, 20 United States, one in Canada, one in Mexico. Who do they serve? Who do the Shriners Hospital for Children serve?
We serve any child from the first day of birth to their 18th birthday, regardless of they can afford it or not. We do not discriminate against any child or young lady, whoever needs our services. We are there to provide everything of which they need.
When and where was the first Shriners Hospital for Children started?
The first hospital was started in New Orleans in 1920. And we opened that hospital with 13 patients. And the cost for the year, for the whole year, was $25,000.
For a whole year?
For 1 year.
And now what is it?
Today, the budget in Philadelphia is $42 million. And with that, we have our main thrust for the budget is treatment, teaching, and research. And that's 85% of our budget, which is $42 million each year.
$25,000 the first hospital, that's more than you spend an hour in Philadelphia right now with
that doesn't even cover a minute.
Care. Wow. How does a youngster get admitted to the Shriners Hospital?
Any child can call directly. We've made it so simple now for a child that with needs of pediatric spinal cord or cleft palate or burns, all you have to do is contact the Shriner, call the 1-800 number, which we will put on the screen for you. It's 1-800-281-4050, and you can make all the arrangements on the telephone. We simplified everything so that people don't have to have a waiting list, a waiting time. They can come right to our hospital, have a screening clinic for them, and we generally, we generally see 50 to 100 patients a day. So far this year, we can approximately see 100,000 children throughout our whole Shrine complex.
I understand now the treatment of children. It's well over 1 million children have been treated since the beginning?
Very much so, yes. And we will continue to do this because we have the means and resources financially to do what we do for the children. The one nice thing about Shriners Hospital, we do not have to abide by the insurance policies which say you can only stay 3 days. Our doctors make the decision on when that child is ready to go home. It's not a case of, well, you can only stay 3 days. Our average patient day is 5.6 days out of every patient that we see. Our mini clinics are every day, Monday through Friday, from 7:30 to 5 o'clock in the evening.
I've been at the Philadelphia Hospital many times, not as a patient, but as a Shriner. And the last time I was down there, several months ago, I was really impressed with that new x-ray facility that they have.
Yes.
Where the other facility, correct me if I'm wrong, but it's like with the new one, only like less than 10% of radiation the child's exposed to?
Yes.
Less than 10%?
Yes, it's less than 10% so that they're not exposed to radiation. We have a research center across the street on the seventh floor where we do all of the innovative new procedures that are being done. And I might add, I was very, very fortunate to be involved with three of the top surgeons in the United States, which was Mike Clancy, the chief of staff. In 1977, he introduced to the United States the Isaroff program, which is the lengthening of limbs. The second doctor was Dr. Randy Betts. He was the spinal cord injury doctor at our hospital. He introduced the telescope rod, where they didn't have to open up the child's back every time the child grew. He had this new procedure as a telescope, like a submarine periscope comes up, and they were just lengthening the rod. The last one was just this past summer, the young fellow from Baltimore, Maryland, where Dr. Scott Cozen was the lead surgeon. He found this young boy had a poisonous in his system for his hands and his feet. They cut both feet off, cut both hands off, and Ion, the little boy, would get around our hospital on a motor scooter that he propelled himself, and we just did it at CHOP with 15 other surgeons. Took 18 hours to put both hands back on, and at no cost to that child or family whatsoever.
I think that's an important factor when you talk about the cost of healthcare today. Astronomical. It's grown proportionally every day. And all this work is done without a cost to the family or the patient. How is that possible?
Well, we have various ways of raising money. Like here in Berks County, we're very, very fortunate to be able to go to supermarkets such as, and I'm going to mention their names because they're very generous to us, Redner's Supermarkets, Walmart, Weaver's Markets. They allow us to stand outside their stores, hand out our literature, and people drop money into our containers that they have. We also have the Pretzel Bowl game at Albright College, which is very, very generous to the Shrine of Philadelphia and also all of our Shriners here in Berks County.
I think it'd be a good time to bring in Paul now. Paul Shaw, the hospital ambassador for Rajah. What is a hospital ambassador, first of all, Paul? What are some of your duties?
I look at the jobs that I have basically in three areas. Number one is to promote our hospitals. We provide, through our hospital service unit, parades, functions, so forth, where we can show the public. The expression is we're probably the world's greatest philanthropy, and that's been quoted. But I think in a lot of cases, too, we're the world's best kept secret. I'm amazed in my travels as to the people that I talk to, and I just had an experience within this past week where people will come to me and say, what do Shriners do? They associate us with our antique cars and with our musical units and our parade and so forth, but they don't know what we do. So promoting our hospitals is a very important factor. The other part is support. I do that basically through a driver coordinator, and we'll get into that a little bit later about what we do with drivers and how we do it. And then also fundraising. Frank alluded to the Pretzel Bowl, which I am heavily involved in, and also others. Our greatest support comes from our patients, and many of them are so appreciative that they are willing to go forth and help us with a promotion. And I have the distinct responsibility for getting patients to functions like the Pretzel Bowl. We just recently did a power lift for kids where we use, and the patients are more than happy to explain, and we tell the profile what has happened to the child and so forth. It's the best way we know how to advertise and get it out to the public as to what we do.
And these children come from all walks of life. It doesn't matter the economic or social status of the parents or any other family member. We do it because we love what we do. And being a Shriner is more than just wearing a red fez and singing in the chanters or playing a musical instrument or driving a little car. We do this because we love the kids. We love to be around, love to be involved with them. And I think it's good because it allows, I think, an extension of one's own self. That it's not just saying, well, I'm an adult, so I have adult activities, but it's treating children in a very, very special way. And all I think you have to do is walk through the hospital, anyone in the hospital, I've been fortunate to be at a couple of them, walk through just one of the hospitals, and see where the children inspire, I think, us. They really do. You might feel sorry for them because laying there in the state that they are, but they inspire us. Am I wrong?
You're correct, and I can allude to that. One of my most impressive units or group of kids down at the Shriners Hospital, quote-unquote, can be found just hanging around. They're members of the Halo Club. And Halo traction is not something that's very pleasant. These are kids that are in traction because they're going to go through spinal surgery. And, of course, the Halo is affixed to their head, and it's tied to weights, and they are trying to strengthen the vertebrae so that they can go into surgery. But what makes these kids so interesting is they create invitations for new members when they get their Halo affixed. They've created their own T-shirts and so forth. So it's an atmosphere that you don't see in a lot of other hospitals. I'm totally impressed with it, and I have to tell everybody about my experiences with the Halo Club, and these children come from all walks of life. They're there for long periods of time, and yet you never hear a whimper, a cry, or anything about them. They're busy, they're active, and they're, you know.
And I think the stereotype of the hospital being a sterile environment, they are for the operating and so forth. But you walk through the halls, and the staff are happy to show you what they do. And Frank, I know you've been there an awful lot and over the years, and you can attest to the fact that you stop and talk to any staff member, and they'll be happy to show you around and extend themselves to you.
Absolutely right. We have over 300 employees there. We have 15 doctors that are all surgeons, and they are the most delightful people to work with, to be around. There's never a problem. There's never anyone that would say to you, oh, I don't know. What they do say to you is, let me help you, and I will find out what I can do to ease the pain and solve the problem. We have great employees there. They're willing to go over and above. I know when we had the snowstorms last year and the years before that, the staff would willingly stay there, wouldn't even think of going home without having the other nurses and the RNs, everybody come in and help support them. We have one of the finest staff in Philadelphia.
I can attest to the fact, being there for several meetings, particularly a luncheon meeting, and the quality of food is certainly above any other hospital I've ever been in.
Well, I'll tell you, the people over at Temple come over to our hospital to have their lunch, not only for the price, but because we have a variation of food that everyone can enjoy. And every morning we serve the soft pretzels free of charge to anyone that comes in there about 7 to 8 o'clock. They can go up to the cafeteria and have Philadelphia soft pretzels and coffee.
Paul, we talked about your duties as transportation coordinator, and you handle the High Valley area. Perhaps you could expound upon what is the transportation of the children. What does that include?
We provide transportation to and from the Shriners Hospital at no cost to the patient, family, and so forth. We have within Rajah Shrine approximately, I think our last honor or our rolls showed about 50-some drivers. Since the record keeping was taken at the Shriners Hospital in Philadelphia, our drivers have done over 6,000 trips transporting patients to and from the hospital in Philadelphia. And when you consider the average day for a driver is about 6 or 7 hours, because he stays right with the family, brings the family back, and so forth, that equates to about 40,000 hours that our drivers have put forth and volunteered in transporting patients to and from the hospital. Our geographic area is broken down into 5 areas. And again, you alluded to the fact that
These are geographical areas you're talking about within our jurisdiction.
Schuylkill County, Berks County, Lancaster County, Northampton County, I have Lehigh County, and so forth. We have driver coordinators basically in each one of those areas. And when the call comes in that we need to transport a patient to the hospital, the driver coordinator takes over. He has a number of drivers under his wing, and basically assigns the patient to a driver, and then the driver takes over from there and is responsible for getting the patient to and from the hospital. There is a co-driver involved, so there's always two people in the vehicle transporting the
patient. You mentioned number of trips, and it's done, I think, is it mileage? And I can say for a fact, when I was potentate and a few years after Frank was, but one of the proudest moments that I had was, and I'm sure for you as well, Frank, when you get that bar for how many trips that a driver makes, these are all volunteer people. and you give them the stripe that they put on their jacket for how many trips they've made. Just tears of joy, because they have made, and from here I'm not exactly sure how many trips before they get that little badge, but it's a badge of honor that they have made, and some of the people have badges all the way down their arm. They have made hundreds of trips.
It starts basically at 17 trips. That's the hospital recognition program. We have our own recognition program at Rajah Shrine that the hospital service unit started 3 years ago. And believe it or not, we have several drivers who have done over 300 trips. We have several drivers that have done over 200 trips. And we honor these drivers within our halls. We have a plaque down there with the drivers' names and so forth. So the hospital recognizes them, and Rajah Shrine recognizes the drivers for their efforts and their time of volunteering mm-hmm. to the hospital.
And a lot of that money for the transportation, that's a special fund set up through Rajah, that's administered through our treasurer, and that is the money we raise when we see us out at our locations, the Redditors Markets, the Walmarts, and Weavers. And I can relate a story that happened a year ago when I was at the Redditors in Sinking Spring, when a little girl came out and she kind of waved at me, and she was with a woman who I found out later was her grandmother, and she disappeared out in the parking lot and came back in and handed me a $20 bill because she couldn't reach where we had the canister to put the $20 bill in. So I went over with her and put it in, and she said, thank you. She's saying to me, thank you. And her grandmother signaled me to come outside, and she said, that little girl, and she was treated several years ago, couldn't even walk, and she was skipping and running, about 8 years old, 9 years old. And the grandmother's thanking me, and I was thanking her as well. But just that's the interaction you have from people.
Paul, illustrious sir, I think it's beyond reproach that we mention Enterprise Car Company. They are very, very generous to us. We started back in, I think it was 1987, using their facilities. They have a golf tournament each year, and they donate handsomely to our transportation fund. And not only that, we have a airline called Air Lifeline out of New York with John Wurzberger, who is the CEO and chairman of the board on Wall Street, who is willing and able and flies our children anywhere in the United States, such as if a child is burned here in Berks County, all we do is call him. He flies here to the Reading Airport. He transport that child up to the Boston Burn Center at no cost to the parents or child whatsoever. And they bring them back, and as many times as we need them, they're right here for us. I think it's important that we give them a little recognition, the Air Lifeline, and also Enterprise Car Company.
And also in the possibility of Bob Weaver
yes.
Chevrolet does a nice job in providing cars for the guys that drive in the Pottsville area. But when you talk about all of the transportation and the things that go into it, it's all done from the heart. Everybody. I don't think anybody would give anyone those badges back. They just love doing it. And I look forward to a day when I'm completely retired that I can do that as well.
I have to agree with you, Greg. I can't tell you the number of stories that we certainly don't have the time to. Personal gratification, where you have a grandmother comes up and throws her arms around you. You know, don't know her from Adam, and thanking you for taking care of her child. And if you've ever been in that situation, it's a tremendous feeling, because you're helping someone else. And that's what I think every Shriner driver feels when they get involved. You also develop a personal relationship with the family. In a way, you somehow become a part of the family. I've had people bring me cookies, cake, things that are totally not necessary, but they show their appreciation in a way that they realize what you're doing for them, and that comes to the heart that I just can't describe it. You know, it's a gratifying feeling.
So it's not just as a member of the Shrine. There's many things that we can do, and I think we'll be exploring that in the next half hour. The committees and the different club units that we have in Rajah, somebody can become a part of. But number one, support of the hospitals. No matter what else, it always comes back to that. We do a lot of activities, and we try and make a disclaimer that if there's different activities and the money raised goes to that particular club or unit for the activities, also to Rajah's general fund. But if there's something earmarked for Shriners Hospital, 100% of that money goes to that. For example, we just had our 65th Pretzel Bowl right here in the campus of Albright, and we've raised close to $3 million in those years. That's a lot of hard work, and it's a lot of money, but it goes to such a good cause. All of it does go into, Frank, you better answer this, directly into the hospital funds.
Oh, absolutely. 85% of every dollar goes directly to support the hospital and to the children. 15% is administrative money that's used for down in Tampa, where our headquarters is, and also for personnel in the local hospitals. But we have to ongoing, continually raise more and more money because of the cost of living and the cost of wages going up and up and up and up. And we take care of all of our surgeons in the Philadelphia Hospital. We pay all their malpractice insurance, which is astronomical. As any of the doctors are listening to it here in Berks County, they know what a big event that is for them and also for us.
Frank, as a longtime member of the Shrine, and particularly Rajah, and being a member of the board of directors down at Philadelphia Hospital, going forward, what is your main concern for the children's hospitals?
Well, we continually must find the children that need our needs. It's so important for us. Here in the United States, we have prenatal care for the parents, the mothers especially, that the European countries do not provide. So we continually are looking for children for our hospital, and the most important thing is the research, that we can continue to find new, easy ways to support our children that we have in our hospital. And also everything that we do for the hospital and for the children is basically up and coming, and hopefully we can set new records and continue to do what we're doing.
And Paul, let me ask you the same thing. What do you feel is the most main concern going forward as far as Shriners Hospitals?
I think it's basically what Frank has stated also in the future of our hospital. We need patients. We're constantly looking for patients. We need to keep our facilities working and our staff working. And it's a big challenge today because, like you see and you observe today, the hospital business and the healthcare business in general is very competitive. I just happened to notice coming in here tonight the billboards just around the Reading area advertising hospitals. So we have competition, and so we have to be diligent in our search for patients and to keep our hospitals. Fundraising is another effort that we need to concentrate on totally. Going forth, there's some concerns, and those are the things we have to address.
I'd like to thank very much, illustrious sir, Frank Caltagirone, past potent head of Rajah Shrine. Thank you very much, Frank, for being with me. Frank, President Emeritus of the Board of Directors of the Shriners Hospital in Philadelphia. Paul, thank you very much, a hospital ambassador on behalf of Rajah Shrine, also one of the driver coordinators that we have. We're going to take a break, and you're going to get a chance to see some of the children that are treated at the Shriners Hospital for Children. These couple of announcements that are coming up, and we'll be back in just a few minutes with our second half of the program. Be talking with some members of Rajah Shrine Board of Directors and looking at the 25th annual Rajah Chanters Afternoon of Music next April.
Love is jokes.
Love is making funny faces.
First you had to meet somebody, then you had to dance with them, and then you had to kiss with them.
You almost got it.
At Shrine's Hospitals for Children, love is so much more.
Love is walking.
Love is being able to sit up straight.
Yeah, you got it, Maya.
Love is playing with my brothers.
At Shriners Hospitals for Children, love is being able to hold my dad's hand.
Love is standing tall.
At Shriners Hospitals, love is making kids' dreams come true.
$19 a month from people like you help Shriners Hospitals for Children help kids like me.
Every year, Shriners Hospitals for Children helps over 100,000 kids discover what love to the rescue really means, regardless of their family's ability to pay.
Love is a straight leg.
Love is walking farther.
Will you send your love to the rescue today?
When you do, you're not just giving us the care we need, you're giving us
hope,
strength,
joy,
independence.
But we can't do it without you. Just 63 cents a day can change a child's life forever, like it did for me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for giving.
Please call or go online now.
Help inspire a kid like me. Call or go online now.
You call, says you care.
Every day,
I bring my expertise.
We bring our love for science for the benefit of children.
I bring a smile.
We bring out smiles.
We bring technology to improve the lives of kids.
I bring compassion regardless of the family's ability to pay.
And together, we bring our love to the rescue.
Hi, and welcome back to our program featuring the Rajah Shriners in Reading. The first half of the program, a chance to discuss some of the activities of the Shriners Hospital for Children, to which we support. Now in the second half hour, we're going to be talking about Rajah Shrine in particular and some of our activities. My name is Greg Lewis. I'm past potentate and director of public relations for Rajah Shrine here in Reading. And with me now is the chief rabbin of Rajah Shrine for 2015, Larry Bortz. Our rental guide, which is Mike Zerbe, and also a little bit later we're talking to Roy Merkel, who's one of the chanters, and we've got a lot to discuss as far as our afternoon of music is concerned. But Larry, starting with you as the chief for band, that'd be equal to, if somebody's not familiar with it, the potentate is our highest office, and this year Glenn Sadison from Schuylkill-Haven area, and the chief for band would be equal to like a vice president, and although we can't officially say it, but Larry's in line to be our next potentate, and that's how it works, and Mike's a few years behind him, and Larry, as you come up through the line, a lot of activity, a lot of things going on. Rajah Shrine's very busy, isn't it?
Absolutely. We have more activities than the average person would actually realize that we have. We have a bingo every week. We have a circus every year. We have a football game, a baseball game that we sponsor. We have many activities that are open to the general public that they can come and enjoy themselves. We have raffles. We have horse races. We have a lot of activities that you don't have to be a Shriner to come and enjoy yourself as a Shriner does automatically.
2015 thus far, and here we are in November, almost through the year, but a lot of activities taking place throughout the whole year. Maybe people don't realize, but like you say, a lot are open to the public. But when you look back at 2015, we start off the year with the circus, which everybody knows about the Shriner Circus. It was in March in Hamburg, and we had great weather for the past few years, but this past March we hit one night where it snowed.
Correct. This is the first year in the history of the circus that we had to cancel a night of the circus, and it was a shame it had to happen, but Mother Nature took over, and we were the victim of Mother Nature that evening. But hopefully this year we won't have that problem. This year, meaning 2016, and we'll have a great circus again. It's Hammond Circus that we will be using, and we wish everyone that in the area come to our circus, because they're going to have a great show for us again this year.
Yeah, Jim Hammond does an excellent job. Mm-hmm. Every year, this is year after year, he comes back with bigger and better acts. I say that every year, but it seems that he just gets a hold of these people and bring them in. And you can tell the reaction, because if people leave the circus, oh, that was a great show, great circus. And you see the kids walking out smiling and happy, and you know we've accomplished a lot.
Well, the greatest feeling that we can have is just watching the expression on the children's faces. I mean, they just light up as soon as the clowns are there, or a funny act is going on, and the parents are just sit back, and they're second to none when it comes to the clowns and the circus and the kids. The kids just light up, and the whole circus takes off from that point on.
And it's not just a circus on the two rings. There's the atmosphere around it. Mm-hmm. I think that's just important with the elephant ride, with the moon bounce and everything else, face painting. So it's not just the acts. It's everything else around. I think that adds to the whole evening of it.
Absolutely. The fact that the kids can even ride some of the animals that are there, they just wait in line to get on a camel or an elephant, or ride a little pony or anything that they can get themselves involved in. They have a fantastic time. The circus is just wonderful family activity.
And Ron Clay is our circus chairman, promises another bigger and better circus for 2016.
He's been doing a great job for the last couple of years, and we know he's going to do another fantastic job this year. He always does.
We talk about some of the other programs, that things that we do. With the principal, we just spoke about that in the first half hour, about their philanthropy, that it supports their philanthropy, and Albright College participates us with that. Mm-hmm. We also have a night at the Fightin' Phils, and we're very happy to have the Reading Phils, now forerunner of Fightin' Phils, along with us. Yep. And Scott Unsinger and everybody at the Fightin' Phils, boy, what a great organization.
Yep. Oh, without a doubt. We were very fortunate this year. The fellow sitting alongside of me, Mike, was in charge of both the football game and the baseball game. That was his responsibility. I thought he did a great job for representing Rajah Shrine and of course the two football and the baseball organizations themselves. And everyone that was there certainly did have a good time.
Also glad to welcome to the program for the first time Mike Zerbe, who is the Oriental Guide, and that's about four or five rungs down the ladder. But someday, your day will come to serve as potentate. Mike, when we talk about the Shriners, what does it take for somebody to become a member of the Shrine in particular, or in general, and Rajah Shrine in general?
Well, they have to be a Mason. They have to join Blue Lodge, and then we recommend that they go through consistory and then come to the Shrine. There's numerous shrines in Pennsylvania, depending on their geographic region. We have Berks County, Lancaster County, Lebanon County, Carbon County, Lehigh. We service a big area, and we encourage, after they become a Mason, to follow through in their Masonic travels and become a Shriner also.
And Larry alluded to it for a second about all the committees we have, but we have over 40 different units and clubs of Rajah, and there seems to be something for everyone, you could say. A new unit start up this year, the motorcycle, the Mystic Riders, a new motorcycle. Anybody interested in motorcycle riding? We've got something for them. We got an Anglers, which is for the fishermen that are members. We also have several bands. We've got the Chanters. We've got the golf club. We've got so many different things that can do. And we talk about not just the man joining, but the family joining as well, because we want them to be a part of the activities. And with so many things that we do, a membership picnic that we do in June that is open again to anybody who'd like to come out and see what we do. Am I right, Larry?
Absolutely. The clubs and units, getting back to the two newest ones, which were the Anglers a couple of years ago and the motorcycle group this year, there was such a big response that both of those groups have somewhere 40 or 50, 60 members initially when they first started out, and that just shows how much of an interest there was in that type of activity that hadn't been available before, but we do have it now. But again, anything that you'd like to do, we have basically covered. Even if you have a car, you have a tractor, you have a little car. The shrine is basically the face of the masonry, because we're in the public's eye more than anything else, because we're in parades. Mm-hmm. And the chanters, that group which you're in, they're singing constantly here, there, everywhere. The bands are always outperforming. So we are getting more and more recognized by everybody, and this red fez is being seen around town and around the country.
We have Legion of Honor. Mm-hmm. And the Motor Corps, of course, with the cars. Shacks Court, which is a group that aids the potentate as he goes through. We have so many things to do. Provost Guard, which is very active with holding security. We take care of security for a lot of the functions and park cars at our post picnic and some other things. So somebody comes in, and let's say they're not as interested in that, but they like to help. We've also got several committees. The Sportsman's Raffle Committee. We have the committee to help with the principal. We have committees all over the place. That's like the circus committee. That's has right. about 40, 50 people that help on that committee, because it takes a lot of people to do these things. It's not just there's a circus comes to town, we take tickets, but we sell tickets. There's so many things to be done.
Well, we realize a lot of hands makes little work, and that seems to work out very well for us, and we're very fortunate that we have so many members that are willing to contribute and help in that direction, don't you think?
Yeah, there are a lot of people that don't want to be in the front, be in the lights, and stand forward of the activities. Just as many people are standing behind doing the small things which make the whole shrine effective. There's no small job in this whole organization.
We also talk about, you alluded to it a moment ago, about the jurisdictions. We cover nine counties, and there's the clubs that exist up in Schuylkill County Club. There's one in the Wren area, Lancaster, London. There's new one start up in Carbon County. Mm-hmm. It's all over Lehigh Valley, so if somebody doesn't want to come to Reading, we go to them. And they have dinners at all these different areas. They have different meetings, and it gets them involved that they say, well, geez, we can't take a night to come down to Reading to do something. You have your own dinner in your own area.
Yeah, a lot of them don't have that opportunity to travel at night, but they can travel locally and close by to their particular location and club or unit that they're involved with, and it makes it convenient for them. So it's a good job.
I want to bring Roy in here. Roy Markle, you've been a member of the Chanters going back a long time.
We won't even discuss the time.
But coming up in 2016 will be one of the activities of next year will be our 25th annual afternoon music. And we've had so many memories along the years. And I'll have to say that the guy to my left here, Larry, has played the drums in a couple of the shows and get to see it from musician side. But Roy, take us back to the formation of that back in 1991.
Moving back, the president of our chanter unit at that time was Guy Miller. And he, and I'm going to use the term, he had a dream that we, as a group of singing men, could perform and present a show which would benefit our chanter unit, and we could benefit others thereafter. So he came up with the idea of having an afternoon of music, which was the start and is the blossoming of his flower bed, as we would call it. Unfortunately, Guy is no longer with us, but I'm sure he is watching us from above and is singing along with us today.
We started the shows in, what was the Rajah Theater, North 6th Street in Reading.
Correct.
And the first one, 1991 to 2001, were downtown at the North 6th Street Theater. And then we moved over to Scottish Rite in West Reading, and now up at Kutztown. And a variety of shows, themes over the years, country and western and Broadway and all that jazz and patriotic. What are some of your highlights, something that you remember?
Well, I'm thinking of the time we did the show for the year. Each month, we selected a song appropriate to that month. And that gives you a large variety of songs. But I think the best part is, as we're singing, when we can present a child that was taken care of by the hospital at our show, I think that's always a highlight, both for the child and for us also, because that's an indication of what our work is for.
when you talk about all the different shows that were done, it of course brings to the fact that with the different themes, it's also brought out a lot of individual talent. And we're fortunate over the years, in the past 24 of them, we've had different people have been on the show. Matter of fact, a lot of the Chanters, but featured vocals have included Jonathan Reinhold, I'm sure you remember him, Brian Gibson, a well-known local artist, Debbie Greenewalt, also she'd acted as MC a couple of times, Carol Kiefer, Diana Genzel, Karen Reppert, Aaron Martin, and Craig Caltagirone, whose father's on the first half with me. He sang and danced one year, and he was also involved as MC another time. And it brings people in from the community. It's not just what we do as Chanters. We involve people from the community.
Dave Klein was another one.
Yes, and his
Mountain
band.
Boys.
Yes, yes. Happy Dutchman band the one year. Basically, brass was there. Rob Stoneback, big band. And the last couple of years, we had the pleasure of having with us the world-renowned Ringo Band. And what a great group of musicians. We've been fortunate all the years we've had these to have the different people with us that have been performing. We'll get back to that in a moment. Larry, selling things for 2016, other than a Chanters Afternoon of Music. What's planned for
next year? The way it was going, I didn't think there was anything else going on. Yes, we have an awful lot going on. We have jewelry raffles. We have a basket bingo for the ladies. We have our membership picnic, which we talked about earlier. And anyone that was interested, they can come out to Orchard Road, which is near Lake Onalani, and come to our membership picnic. That's the end of May, I think it is, Mike. Mm-hmm. Is that about right?
Yep.
We have a car show. We have an Elvis night that's going to be put on by one of the clubs. The Chanters, yourselves, you're going to have a spaghetti night where people can come and eat spaghetti. So we have a lot of different things that are going on at the Shrine that are open to the public, along with our own club and meeting nights that generally take place once a month. The Shrine clubs, which we spoke about earlier, they're scattered throughout our whole district. And those people also meet once a month, and it's like a dinner club. They get together, they eat, and they're still representatives of Rajah Shrine, even though they're not generally able to get to our complex during a normal meeting night. But they have their little gatherings up there, and they're still part of us. So we enjoy having all types of activities that are going on within the Shrine.
What do you feel, Larry, is the most important to you as a member of Shrine?
Well, when we joined the Masons, it was told us that Masonic interests make a good man better. And I think the Shrine is an extension of that. I think we as Shriners are basically more of a PR for the Masons than any other group, again, because of our red fezes and being intertwined with the public in parades and concerts and so on and so forth. We're more visible and people are able to get and see us in a different light than they would the Masons, but we're still all Masons, and it's just a good feeling to know that you're there, you have a philanthropy, and you're able to help one another, and the fraternity is fantastic that we have amongst ourselves.
Mike, what do you feel is most important to
you? I think the visibility. Blue Lodge, pretty much the only time you actually see Blue Lodge members in the public is for a Masonic funeral service or for a parade, local parades. The Shrine is more active. It's community-oriented. It's family-oriented. A lot of the activities are based around that. That's why we have a baseball game. We have a football game. We have all these other activities that you try and find something that suits them, and that's where I feel that I get the most out of that. Try and find that niche that you can find somebody else that enjoys it.
Roy, of course, as members of the Chanters, we go out and do about 25 to 30 appearances a year. Parades, we sing at different church functions, civic organizations, wherever it might be. And I think the important thing about that, just as Michael and I alluded to, is the public relations. That's our form. That's what we do.
I think my biggest pleasure is when I can transport a child and a parent to the Shriners Hospital. That's what we really exist for. That's why we wear the red fez. And we've got to begin believing that we are in a we world and not a me world. We're not in here by ourselves.
Right.
We're in here for everybody. And I enjoy the singing with the other men. And Larry, I must warn you ahead of time, the Chanter unit is one of your most popular units in the Shrine. And we won't let you forget it.
Well, I appreciate that. Of course, you realize you're second to the band.
I was a member of the string band and
band.
I was just going to say, no matter which group or unit that you go to visit, they let you know that they're number one.
That's right.
So there's a friendly competition between all the clubs and units, and that's a good thing.
But seriously, the musical units in Rajah are very well received, and we compete amongst ourselves, amongst other shrine units, I should say, shrine temples, and the bands and the chanters come out very well. So we're very well representative of Rajah Shrine any time that the musical groups are out there in public.
I believe your band unit brought a trophy back from Virginia Beach. They did not.
No, we brought a couple like you did also.
Okay, yeah. All
they
right.
Were either first or second. So yes, we always have fun when we go to Virginia Beach. That's a Mid-Atlantic Shrine Association competition among all the shrine temples that are in the area. Now, Pennsylvania has 7 shrine temples, but that's part of the Mid-Atlantic. Mm-hmm. Mid-Atlantic has, I think, 24 or 25 temples in it.
25 now, because there's a new temple that was formed under the auspices of the Shriner National in Heidelberg, Germany.
Right.
2 years ago, and they're a member of the Mid-Atlantic Shrine Association. Mm-hmm. And we're happy to say that one of our own members, we alluded to him before, is the president of the, or the chairman of the mm-hmm. circus, but Ron Clay is president of the Mid-Atlantic Shrine Association for this year. We have a call on the line from a home viewer. Please, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Valerie Kessner, and I am interested to know the Rajah Chanters' favorite song to sing.
Well, Valerie, we have a repertoire of about 250 songs, I would say, Roy, right? And we do everything from ballads, Broadway shows. We do a lot of patriotic. We do a lot of sacred songs. And to pick one out would be really, really tough, Valerie. To pick one particular song, myself, I don't have a particular favorite. I just love to sing them all. Right, Roy?
My thought would be that our very last song that we sang just last evening, Why We Sing.
Yes. And it's Why We Sing for the thing, the work that we do on behalf of the hospital.
Yeah.
But we're proud to sing all of our songs. Thank you for the call.
Well, thank you for all you do.
Thank you very much. Nice to hear from you.
It's a wonderful organization.
Thank you. We have a lot of things, I think, in shrine goes unnoticed by the public. Of course, they see the red fez, but there's a lot of work that goes underneath it. Of course, we talk about transportation to hospitals. But all the work that we do in preparation for bringing people to the circus, preparation for the baseball game that we work with the people, preparation for the football game. So it's not just one or two individuals. And correct me if I'm wrong, but I think last year's count was almost 300 volunteers for the circus alone, with the ladies as well, and children that
absolutely.
Came out.
Absolutely. There's so many so much activity behind the scenes, which you alluded to earlier, taking people, picking people up, helping people. We have many Shriners that are now elderly and can't drive, so we pick them up, they come along and they still help. They still want to be part of the activity that's going on, but you're right, we have so much of need for people to help us to make something work as well as it works. And again, like I said earlier, we're very proud of the way our members pitch in, and they do what they have to do in order to make whatever the happening is at the time happen.
We have a nice facility, almost 50 acres out off Route 73, between it's near Blandon, between Route 222 and 61, take Route 73 over near the breast of the Alani Dam. And you can see our buildings that are there and our facilities. And we use those facilities almost all the time. There's something going there almost every night. And there again, it takes somebody who's going to handle the cleanup of those, somebody who does the booking. Mm-hmm. It's our secretaries in the office. It's our secretary, our recorder, and our treasurer. And the members of the trustees that, of course, mm-hmm. are responsible for mowing the grass. So it's not just the officers that you see, it's just the public face. There's so many people behind the scenes as well.
That's absolutely true. We have one side of the road coming into the complex is a soccer field.
Absolutely, open to the kids.
The young kids are playing on the soccer field all the time. We have a campground for the caravaners. They actually come and they park and they have a weekend caravaning parties there.
Mobile homes. RVs.
We have, you're right, so many things that are out there on that property that are available to people to partake in, so.
And I think, Mike, more and more we are getting family-oriented.
We are family-oriented, and one of the comments I'd like to make is pretty much our activities are rain, snow, sleep, or whatever. Unfortunately, our schedules are so packed for the year. Larry's put his schedule together for next year already. And once it gets to the schedule, it's pretty well, we have to live by that schedule. So we're, all of our activities, whether it's a baseball, football, the circus, we got to do it whatever the weather throws at us.
We had, thinking back, and Roy, you might remember with me a few years ago, we had some snow on a Saturday night for our show just before the afternoon music on Sunday. And I can remember setting up, the florists couldn't get there on Saturday afternoon, so we were setting up. As the curtain was going up, we're putting the last plants, the last things into place on the stage. So no matter what, come the, next April 17, 2016.
The show must go on.
Absolutely. Right. Absolutely. Well, thank you very much, Roy. Nice to have you with us, Roy.
Well, thank you.
Merkel from the Rajah Chanters, our oral guide, Mike Zerbe, and our chief for band, and next year's potentate, Larry Bortz. Thank you very
thank
much
you.
For being with us. I'd like to thank also Frank Caltagirone for being with us in the first portion of our program, and to Paul Shaw. And I also have to thank the producer of our program, Ron Weitzel, who co-produced the program and put things together as well with yours truly. I'd like to thank everybody who was involved with the program tonight or today. We certainly like to say thank you to our host here at the BCTV for the fine job that they do. And if you'd like to know more information about Rajah Shrine, please contact us at our office, 610-916-9000, or look on the rajahshrine.org website. We're also on Facebook. And the fine people here at BCTV do a wonderful job. I'd like to thank them and for being a part of their community programming. I'm Greg Lewis. I'd like to thank you for joining us here on our program tonight, talking about the Rajah Chanters. And I hope you gained a better knowledge of what the Shriners are and regarding our purpose. And hope to see you at the Rajah Chanters Afternoon of Music. And that's going to be on Sunday, April 17, 2016 at the Kutztown High School. Until we meet again, thank you very much for joining us. We'll look to see you again in the very near future.